Good evening. I'd like to welcome you to this Good Friday worship service. I'd ask a couple of things. One, you might notice something different. There's a piece of paper that you have right next to you. What I would like you to do is to go ahead right now and write your name on that piece of paper. And over the course of this service, I want you to contemplate and reflect upon your sin. Because we come tonight to worship not our sin, who removes our sin from us. Our sins put Christ on the cross, but it didn't hold him there. He died and was raised for us to remove our sin. But tonight, on this piece of paper, your name represents your sin and your sinful life. And later in the service, I'll tell you what I'd like you to do with that. Additionally, if you don't mind, I know that we typically don't worship on Thursday or Friday evenings. I get it. So what I would like you to do is take out your telephone and let's go completely wireless and disconnect. Don't just mute it. Don't just turn the ringer off. Turn your phone off. And let it not be a distraction for us during our time of worship this evening. I invite you to stand as we make our opening in the beginning. We make our beginning in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, graciously be with us, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ was willing to be betrayed, to be given into the hands of sinners, and to suffer death on the cross, that he might draw the whole world to himself. Grant that we who glory in his death for our forgiveness and life may also glory in his call to take up our cross and follow him through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace.
Reading for Good Friday is from Isaiah chapter 52. Behold, my servant shall act wisely. He shall be high and lifted up and shall be exalted. As many were astonished at you, his appearance was so marred beyond human semblance and his form beyond that of the children of mankind. So shall he sprinkle many nations. Kings shall shut their mouths because of him. For that which he has not been told them, they see, and that which they have not heard, they understand. Who has believed what they heard from us, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, and no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And as one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray, have turned every one to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth, like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent. So he opened not his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away. And as for his generation, who considered that he was cut off out of the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people? And they made his grave with the wicked and with a rich man in his death, although he had done no violence and there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him. He has put him to grief. When his soul makes an offering for sin, he shall see his offspring. He shall prolong his days. The will of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. Out of the anguish of his soul, he shall see and be satisfied. By his knowledge shall the righteous one, my servant, make many to be accounted righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore I will divide him a portion with the many, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out his soul to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he bore the sin of many and makes intercession for the transgressors. This is the word of the Lord.
Respect for Jesus and his holy word, for those that are able, I invite you to stand for the reading of the gospel. Then they led Jesus from the house of Caiaphas to the governor's headquarters. It was early morning. They themselves did not enter the headquarters so that they would not be defiled but could eat the Passover. So Pilate went outside to them and said, "What accusation do you bring against this man?" They answered him, "If this man were not doing evil, we would not have delivered him over to you." Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and judge him on your own law." The Jews said to him, "It is not lawful for us to put anyone to death." This was to fulfill the word that Jesus had spoken to show by what kind of death he was going to die. So Pilate entered his headquarters again and called Jesus and said to him, "Are you the King of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you say this of your own accord, or did others say it to you about me?" Pilate answered, "Am I a Jew? Your own nation and the chief priests have delivered you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would have been fighting, that I might not be delivered over to the Jews. But my kingdom is not from the world." Then Pilate said to him, "So you are a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this purpose I was born, and for this purpose I have come into the world, to bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth listens to my voice." Pilate said to him, "What is truth?" After he said this, he went back outside to the Jews and told them, "I find no guilt in him, but you have a custom that I should release one man for you at the Passover. So do you want me to release to you the King of the Jews?" They cried out again, "Not this man, but Barabbas." Now Barabbas was a robber. Then Pilate took Jesus and flogged him. And the soldiers twisted together a crown of thorns and put it on his head and arrayed him in a purple robe. They came up to him saying, "Hail, King of the Jews," and struck him with their hands. Pilate went out again and said to them, "See, I am bringing him out to you, that you may know that I find no guilt in him." So Jesus came out, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Pilate said to them, "Behold the man." When the chief priests and the officers saw him, they cried out, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and crucify him, for I find no guilt in him." The Jews answered him, "We have a law, and according to that law he ought to die, because he had made himself the Son of God." When Pilate heard this statement, he was even more afraid. He entered his headquarters again and said to Jesus, "Where are you from?" But Jesus gave him no answer. So Pilate said to him, "You will not speak to me? Do you not know that I have authority to release you and authority to crucify you?" Jesus answered him, "You would have no authority over me at all unless it had been given you from above. Therefore, he who delivered me over to you has the greater sin." From then on, Pilate sought to release him, but the Jews cried out, "If you release this man, you are not Caesar's friend. Everyone who makes himself a king opposes Caesar." So when Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and sat him down on the judgment seat at a place that's called the Stone Pavement, and in Aramaic, Gabbatha. Now it was the day of preparation of the Passover. It was about the sixth hour. He said to the Jews, "Behold your king." They cried out, "Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priest answered, "We have no king but Caesar." So he delivered him over to them to be crucified. O Lord, have mercy on us. Our Lord says, "Come unto me, all you who labor and heavy laden, and I will give you rest." Our sins cry out. Our sins cry out.
We have betrayed you with or without the 30 pieces of silver.
Our sins cry out.
We have denied you whether or not we have heard a cock crowing.
Precious Jesus, we cry out to you.
You know the sins we carry, secretly or openly, the way they crush us, the way they tempt. We bring these to your cross.
I invite you to please be seated at this time. If you haven't already, if you will, write your name on that white piece of paper. Contemplate your sins. And when you feel so moved, I invite you to come forward, take a nail, you can hammer your sins to the cross. Thank you.
that he paid that price a long, long time ago. When he gave his life for me on a hill called Calvary. But there's something else I want to know. Does he still feel the nails every time I fail? Can he hear the crowd cry, crucify again? Am I causing him pain? Then I know I've got to change. I just can't bear the thought of hurting him. It seems that I'm so good at breaking your promises. Thank you.
Two others who were criminals were led away to be put to death with him. And when they came to the place that is called the skull, there they crucified him. And the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. And Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." And they cast lots to divide his garments. Our worship service didn't begin tonight. It started last night. We learned on Monday, Thursday, it was a new mandate, mandatum, a new command. And the command was to love one another. In John's gospel alone, the word love is mentioned 57 times, more than the other three gospels combined. The first 12 chapters of John, it's only mentioned 12 times, but from chapter 13 through the end, from the upper room through the end, it's mentioned an additional 45 times. What do you think that Jesus was trying to tell us? We're to love one another. During the 17th century, Oliver Cromwell sentenced one of the soldiers to be shot for his crimes, and that execution was to take place at the evening ringing of the bells, the carillon, the large bells that could be heard all around. Well, they waited, and they waited, and they waited, but the bells never rang that evening. So the soldiers then brought the fiance of that one convicted criminal in front of Oliver Cromwell and said, "This is the reason why the bells never ring." You see, she held on to the great clapper so that when the ringing had occurred, there would be no sound that was made. She was bloodied, and she was bruised, and she was broken. Yet Cromwell said, "Because of your great love, I will not execute your lover." Greater love has no one than this. Then someone laid down his life for the ones they love. Seven words right in the middle of our gospel reading from tonight, from John chapter 19, verse 1. Did you hear it? Then Pilate took Jesus and flogged him. Flogging was used with the flagrum. It was like a whip, but on the end there would be either shards of metal or balls of lead. And when you were flogged, they would have fun and whip as hard as they could. Jesus was stripped down, and they were flogging him. At first, the beating just makes bruising on the skin, and then the blood starts to develop under the pockets. And not only bruising, but with each strike, soon it would start opening up and blood would be oozing out. Flogging was a terrible, horrible, horrible punishment. And in the Old Testament, we are told in Deuteronomy chapter 25, verse 3, that flogging was not to have more than 40 lashes. That was the law according to the Jews. But we know the Romans didn't always obey the Jewish law. Flogging usually ended up in death. Why, Jesus, did you let them flog you? Why, Jesus, did you go through such punishment, so much pain? And Jesus says just one word, "Because I love you." John 19, verse 16, "So he delivered him over to them to be crucified." At that point, Jesus would have to carry his cross. And we know that all of the beating and the flogging, being up all night, and the pain and the torn open back, having to carry the cross all the way, was more than he could handle. They got Simon of Cyrene. They said, you help him carry the cross. And they carried him a little further. Then they laid him back against that rugged cross and hammered his hands and his feet to that cross. Expert historians have told us that crucifixion is not like you see in the movies. It's not this great tall cross where they're crucified really high. They're usually stripped naked just to cause more embarrassment. And when they're crucified, they are merely just a foot off the ground so that you could look them in the eye and spit in their face. And they're so close to being able to get down, but they can't move. And then in crucifixion, it's not the end to kill you. It's the suffocation that kills you. You see what happens in a crucifixion? They keep your knees bent so that you can push up and you can breathe in to get a little oxygen. But the longer you're there, the harder it is for you to push up. The pain from your main nerve in your arm is shooting always into you. Constant pain, constant throbbing, and you get to where you can't exhale. And then you start having the pericardium fill up, that sac that surrounds the heart, and it gets bigger and bigger, and your heart gets smaller and smaller, and it just crushes you. Why, Jesus? Why didn't you call a host of angels down to stop all of this? And Jesus says, because I love you. And he says the first of his seven utterances, Father, forgive them. Not me. You do something wrong to my family, right? You come after me and attack them. You want me to forgive you? But not Jesus. Jesus, they're killing you. Why don't you stop that? Why, Jesus? Because I love them. Oh, Lord, have mercy on us. Lord Jesus Christ, you are the Prince of Peace. When you were mocked, you did not respond with harsh words. When you were tormented, you did not react in anger. When you were nailed to the cross, you prayed for the forgiveness of those who caused you to suffer. Give to us the virtues of gentleness, patience, and forgiving spirit. Teach us to love our enemies and as children of the Heavenly Father to live in your peace. Lord, in your mercy. And the people stood by watching, but the rulers scoffed at him, saying, he saves others, let him save himself. If he is the Christ of God, the chosen one. The soldiers also mocked him, coming up and offering him sour wine and saying, if you are the King of the Jews, save yourself. There was also an inscription over him, this is the King of the Jews. One of the criminals who were hanged railed at him, saying, are you not the Christ? Save yourself and us. But the other rebuked him, saying, do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we are receiving the due reward of our deeds, but this man has done nothing wrong. And he said, Jesus, Remember me when you come into your kingdom. And he said to him, truly I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise. Two criminals, one on his right, one on his left. They deserved to be there, but not Jesus. You know, it wasn't too long before this that Jesus went up on a high mountain with Peter, James, and John, and he was transfigured right there in front of them with Moses and Elijah. And when they came down the mountain, Jesus said, don't tell anybody what happened. And then James and John pulled Jesus aside by themselves and said, Jesus, when you come into your kingdom, give us what we ask for. And he said, what is it you want? They said, we want the place of your right hand and your left hand. Places of position and power. And now who's at Jesus' right hand and who's at Jesus' left hand? Why, Jesus, did you promise paradise to a thief? Why, Jesus, do you continually forgive us when we are a thief from you? And Jesus says, because I love you. O Lord, have mercy on us. Lord Jesus Christ, in your infinite mercy, you heard the plea of the dying thief on the cross next to you. We pray that you would open our hearts to welcome those who turn to you and rejoice in their salvation. When our last hour comes, hold us firm in our faith and bring us to also live with you in paradise. Lord, in your mercy. Standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, woman, behold your son. Then he said to the disciple, behold your mother. And from that hour, the disciple took her to his own home. On the cross, all the disciples abandoned Jesus save one, John. We call him the beloved one. John refers to himself in his gospel as the one who Jesus loved. And yet no one stayed but John. Do you remember Jesus' words at the beginning of his ministry in the early part of the gospel of John? Jesus' first miracle, where he turned water into wine. They were having a great wedding feast, and Jesus' mom was there, and they ran out of wine, and she went to Jesus, and she said, Jesus, they're out of wine. And he said to her, woman, it's not my hour. Interesting, he uses the same words when he's on the cross. It's not a chastisement, woman. It's an endearing term. Woman. And on the cross, the same word, the same term. Woman, behold your son. Son, behold your mother. Why were you worrying about relationships, Jesus, when you're dying on the cross? Why don't you stay and build the relationship? Jesus, in his dying words, was concerned about family, about relationships, and about loving one another like family. Why, Jesus, do you care about relationships so much? And he says, because I love you. O Lord, have mercy on us. Lord Jesus Christ, while you suffered the agony of the cross, your thoughts turned to the welfare of others. Your concern was for your mother and her sorrow. We pray that you would regard with pity all parents who mourn the death of their children, and all parents who sorrow because their children have gotten into trouble or forsaken their faith. By the power of your healing, we pray that parents and children know peace and that relationships be restored. Lord, in your mercy. Now from the sixth hour there was darkness over all the land until the ninth hour. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani? That is, my God, why have you forsaken me? And some of the bystanders hearing it said, this man is calling Elijah. Have you noticed the pattern? The pattern of his words. The beginning were longer phrases, and now it's getting shorter and shorter. You can see the weight of the sin of the world crushing Jesus on the cross. And he says those words, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. I wonder how loud he said those words. Do you think they were confused? We know from the text that they didn't hear him clearly. Because if you say, Eliah, Eliah, that's Elijah, Elijah. And yet they're making fun of him. Call Elijah! Have him come down and save you. Why, Jesus? Why, Jesus? The Father abandoned you. In the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus prayed, Father, take this cup from me, not my will, but thine be done. Not to abandon what he was called for. The Father only turned his back on him twice, once in his temptation at the beginning of his ministry, and now at the end of his life. What would it be like to be abandoned by your family in your time of dire need? Why, Jesus, did you stay? Even your Father abandoned you. And he says, because I love you. O Lord, have mercy on us. Lord God, Father of all people and creator of all that exists, you hold all people in your power. We pray that you would not forsake the world that your Son died to redeem. Even though we still see the influence of sin and evil all around us, assure us of your continued presence in our midst. Help us to know your love in our lives so we can show your presence to others. Lord, in your mercy.
I soak up all our dregs.
After this, Jesus, knowing that all was now finished, said, to fulfill the scripture, I thirst. A jar full of sour wine stood there, so they put a sponge full of the sour wine on a hyssop branch and held it to his mouth. I thirst. The hyssop branch is mentioned in Psalm 51. Purge me with hyssop, that I may be whiter than snow. 51 verse 7. Some have said the hyssop branch was the actual branch they used to dip, to put the blood of the lamb on the doorpost and the lintel. On that journey out of Exodus, on the night the angel of death passed over, on that night, when God set his people free. And the hyssop branch now is being used for a different purpose. A hyssop branch being raised up to the Lamb whose blood will set us free. Why, Jesus? Why did you have to die? And Jesus says, because I love you. O Lord, have mercy on us.
Thanks be to God.
Lord Jesus Christ, you endured not only spiritual anguish, but also physical pain on the cross in our place. We thirst for the healing that only you can provide. When we find ourselves suffering, give us peace and patience to endure the pain that comes our way. Bring to our minds all that you endured for us and give us the strength to bear our burdens by the grace of your holy example. Lord, in your mercy, Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, it is finished. And he bowed his head and he gave up his spirit. It is finished. How many of you have ever run a race before? And how many of you were so glad when you could see the finish line? Ever run a marathon and feel like I just can't get there? And when you see that finish line and you cross that finish line, the joy you have, the relief you have, that it's done. When Jesus says it is finished, it means it is complete. It is tetelestai in Greek. And that it is finished does not mean I just finished a race, like it's over. There's no more to do. It means literally this. It is finished for everybody in the past. It's finished for everybody in the present. And it's finished for everybody in the future. It is complete. Not just one act, but one act for all time. Why, Jesus, did you have to suffer? And he says to you and me, because I love you. O Lord, have mercy on us. I invite you to stand as we come together to confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God
the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He ascended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe.
Lord Jesus Christ, you are the author and finisher of our faith. You did not stop short of finishing the task given to you by your Father for the sake of us and of the world. We pray that you would complete in us also everything that you intend for us, so that as children of the Heavenly Father, we may live for his glory. Lord, in your mercy, please be seated. It was now about the sixth hour, and there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour, while the sun's light failed, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Then Jesus, calling out with a loud voice, said, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." And having said this, he breathed his last, and the earth shook, and the rocks were split. Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. The temple curtain was torn in two. You see, the way the temple was established was there were certain places that people were allowed to go. And the outside was the court of the Gentiles. Jesus met the people on the court of the Gentiles on that Monday after Palm Sunday. You remember he came into Jerusalem triumphant. Everybody said, "Hosanna, Hosanna." He saw everything that was happening and he left. Mark 11, verse 11 said it was the end of the day. The next morning he went back and he cleansed the temple, turned out the money changers. That's in the court of the Gentiles. They didn't think much about the Gentiles. And then you have the court of the women, then the court of the men, then the court of the priests. And then you go inside, you have the holy place. And then there was the Holy of Holies. And a great curtain was a divide. No one was allowed to go behind that curtain save one, the high priest, one day of year on the Day of Atonement. It was such a sacred thing that when the high priest was going to go back there, they would tie bells around his waist and a rope to him. In case he were to go back there, they couldn't hear the bells ringing. Maybe he had a heart attack. They couldn't go in. They would pull him out. No one was allowed to go behind that curtain. You see, in the Holy of Holies was where God resided to the people of Israel. And yet only one man was allowed to go in the presence of God. Yet when Jesus died and the temple curtain was torn in two, it was God's way of saying to you and to me, everyone can come to me because of one man, not a high priest, but the high priest, because of Jesus Christ. All have access to me. Because of my son, because of Jesus and what he has done for us. Why, Jesus, did you have to die? Because I love you, he says. Oh, Lord, have mercy on us. Lord Jesus Christ, as you gave your life on the cross in our place, you commended your spirit into the loving hands of your heavenly Father. Give us the grace to trust in you for all things. When our last hour comes, grant us peace, that we may close our eyes with confidence, knowing that we also will dwell forever in the hands of our Heavenly Father. Lord, in your mercy.
Crucify.
invite you to stand. John chapter 19. After these things, Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple of Jesus, but secretly for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate that he might take away the body of Jesus, and Pilate gave him permission. So he came and took away his body. Nicodemus also, who earlier had come to Jesus by night, came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 75 pounds in weight. So they took the body of Jesus and bound it in linen cloths with the spices, as is the burial custom of the Jews. Now in the place where he was crucified there was a garden, and in the garden a new tomb in which no one had yet been laid. So because of the Jewish day of preparation, since the tomb was close at hand, they laid Jesus there. O Lord, have mercy on us.
Crucified. There is victory in my Savior's loss, in the crimson flowing from the cross. Pour over me, pour over me. Once and for all, oh Lord, I lay it down. Oh Lord, I lay it down. Help me to lay it down. Oh Lord, I lay it down. Oh, let this be. My Lord, with thee crucified, be lifted high as my kingdoms fall, once and for all, once and for all. Once and for all, once and for all.